Today on Answers with Bayless Conley.
And I believe when we're in the right place, God commands provision to come. He will command a company to give you a job. He will command doors of favor and blessing to open for you.
Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. I've been a pastor going on 4 decades, but if you'd seen some of the earlier chapters of my life, you probably never would have guessed that I would have ended up serving in gospel ministry. Growing up, I was raised a normal Southern California kid. But as a teenager, my life quickly spiraled into drug and alcohol addiction and a search for answers. After a number of near-death experiences, I came to know Jesus and experienced His life-changing power. I found out that He was what I'd been searching for and that there were answers in His Word. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers. It's important to be in the right place. And I want to talk to you about that today, how the Holy Spirit will direct us to specific places, yes, to bring illumination, yes, provision, and mission. Important places that the Holy Spirit will direct us to be for illumination, for provision, and for mission. Let's talk about illumination first. I'm sure you're familiar with these scriptures. It's in Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 1 and 2. It says, "The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, 'Arise, go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words.'" There I'll cause you to hear my words. Now, I mean, Jeremiah could have said, "Lord, am I not hearing you now? You know, you're just telling me to go down to the potter's house, so you're already speaking to me. Why don't you just keep speaking? Why do I have to go there?" Well, it was important that he was there because God was going to bring illumination to him. As he went to the potter's house and saw the potter fashioning something on the wheel and it became marred in his hand, and the Lord said to him, "Can I not do as this potter does with Israel? As the clay is in the potter's hand, so Israel is in my hands." And he went on to tell him several things about the future of Israel and gave a word for the nation. But it was important for Jeremiah to be in a specific place to receive the illumination that God had for him. I remember a season in my life. I was actually assistant pastor, and this is probably 37 years ago this occurred. And I just reached, at least in my mind, a really critical point. I was praying hard and looking for answers and just felt like the next move, whatever kind of move I took, that destiny was going to be hinged on it. And I wanted to get it right. And I was just actually stressing about things and really praying a lot, praying often, and not seeming to get a breakthrough, not seeming to get, direction. And I heard about some meetings that were going to be taking place in Anaheim. And immediately when I heard about those meetings, I had a sense inside that I needed to be there. I wouldn't say that I heard words, but I would say that to me, the Holy Spirit was speaking to me. I just knew inside strongly that for some reason, I had to be there. And so I took Janet, she and I came to the meetings, and I think it was a daytime meeting. And I remember the guy said, "All right, y'all get your Bibles out and hold them up. And I thought to myself, this is going to be good. You know, I'm a word man. I like this. So we held up our Bibles. He said, "All right, now put them under your chair. You're not going to need them." And I thought to myself, oh, no. But then he proceeded to explain he was actually going to be teaching out of a not too common version of the Bible. And rather than having us compare the differences, he just wanted us to listen to what he was going to say. I said, okay, that makes sense. And the moment he began to share his message, it was like every other person in the room disappeared, and I was the only one there. And every word he spoke to me spoke directly to my heart. God answered every one of my questions, and so profoundly gave me direction. That day, I will never, ever forget it. It was so important and so pivotal to me. God wants to bring us illumination, but sometimes that illumination is tied to a place, a specific place. Now look with me, if you would, in Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22. Let's talk about provision. Genesis 22 and verse 1. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, Here I am. Then he said, Take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son. He split the wood for the burnt offering, and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. Everyone say, the place. The place. Verse 4, then on the third day, Abraham lifted his eyes and saw the place afar off. Drop down to verse 9, if you would. Then they came to the place of which God had told him. And Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order. And he bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. So he said, Here I am. And he said, Do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Then Abraham lifted his eyes and looked, and there behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up for a burnt offering instead of his son. And Abraham called the name of the place, The Lord Will Provide. As it is said to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. Now certainly this story, you know, is a type of Christ, Calvary, and redemption. I was laid out on the altar. The knife was, you know, poised above my heart. It was going to strike and hurl me into an eternity of separation from God. But thank goodness there was a rustling in the thicket and a substitute was found. And Jesus Christ, the Son of God, laid down on the altar of the cross and he died in my place so that I could go free. God did not withhold his only son. And we understand those things from this story. But you know, on a very, very practical level, it teaches us that God's provision in our lives may be tied to a specific place. God had sent that ram to a specific mountain. What if Abraham had gone to the wrong mountain? What if he'd gotten tired on the journey? I mean, they journeyed for 3 days, and then it says, then he lifted up his eyes, and the place was still far off. What if he thought, man, I'm tired. 3 days and it's still all the way over there. This place looks as good as any. Let's just do this here. The result would have been there would have been no provision. God sent that provision to a specific place. God had ordained that Abraham and the provision meet there. Abraham's going up one side of the mountain. The ram's going up the other side of the mountain. Would you look with me, if you would, in 1 Kings chapter 17. I think this is a really classic example of what we're talking about. 1 Kings, the 17th chapter, and verse 1 says, And Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead said to Ahab, As the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, Get away from here and turn eastward, and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. Everyone say there.
There.
I've commanded the ravens to feed you there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. For he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening. And he drank from the brook. Now, the ravens wouldn't have fed him just anywhere. God said, I've commanded the ravens to feed you there. And listen, God has a there for every single one of us. If Elijah had gone to another brook, he would have missed the blessing. It was by the brook Cherith that God had commanded the ravens to come. In verse 7, it says, and it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. It came time for a change. And you know, our there places sometimes are seasonal. Sometimes things dry up and it's time to say, God, where next? Verse 8. And the word of the Lord came to him, saying, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. Everyone say there. Say there. I've commanded a widow there. In both places, God commanded a blessing. God commanded the ravens, and God commanded a widow. And I believe when we're in the right place, God commands provision to come. He will command a company to give you a job. He will command doors of favor and blessing to open for you. He'll use ravens and widows if he has to. And that doesn't mean there won't be trials. That doesn't mean you won't go through a rough patch now and again. But I believe that when we are in our there place, we can expect God's provision in our life. We can expect God to meet our needs. When Elijah was holed up in the cave, the wind was there and tore apart the rocks and said, God wasn't in the wind. And then there was a fire and it said, God wasn't in the fire. And then there was an earthquake and it said, the Lord was not in the earthquake. And then it was a still, small voice. And the Lord spoke to him.
Are you facing a problem that you need an answer to? In your health, in your relationships, in your finances, or maybe you feel stuck in a situation lacking a clear direction or purpose? You can find answers for your life. You can have direction and purpose with Answers for Each Day, our online daily devotional. Pastor Bayless unlocks the truth of God's Word and shows you how to find answers for your life in an easy-to-read format. Each devotional shows how easy it is to have an intimate relationship with God by living a practical, faith-filled life in Christ. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and sign up for this free resource, these answers of biblical wisdom and teaching are sure to inspire you to dive deeper into what God has for your life. You can receive these inspirational devotionals today for free when you sign up at BaylessConley.com. These beautifully written daily devotionals will deepen your biblical understanding, give you practical steps to create more intimacy in your relationships, and improve your spiritual and physical health. God's Word has the answers for your life. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and sign up, each devotional will challenge you to live better, improve your attitude, and walk out the practical solutions found in God's Word. The Answers for Each Day devotional will strengthen your faith and reignite your passion to pursue God's answers for your life. It's absolutely free. Go online right now, BaylessConley.com, to sign up. That's BaylessConley.com.
I remember once I was at a local mall, had the twins with me. I think they might have been 5. I'm holding their hands. We're walking. And as we're walking in the mall, headed to a particular store, I suddenly had the sense we're supposed to turn around and walk the other way. And it was so odd. I remember thinking, Holy Spirit, is this you? How weird. So I said, kids, come on. And we turned around. They go, Dad, we're going the wrong direction. The store's back that way. I said, it's okay. Just come on. We're walking about 60 seconds. And I hear, Bayless? I turn around and there's a pastor friend of mine sitting in an outside booth in a little cafe there in the mall. So I went up and we sat down and talking to him. He says, Bayless, he said, I'm so glad to see you. He said, I've been praying earnestly about this. I feel like God's put it in my heart that our church is supposed to be involved in missions work in Africa. He said, but I don't have a single contact in the entire African continent. Can you help me? I said, well, yeah, we've got a lot of contacts in a number of different African nations, and it just happens that right now, today, we are hosting a very influential Nigerian pastor in our church. He's with us for the next 3 days, and I think you're supposed to meet him. And so I put them together, and listen, it opened up a whole new vista and a whole new era of missions work in that church. They began to send people. They got connected with that pastor, with that part of Nigeria, and then it was just sort of a snowball effect. Other things happened from there. But it was as simple as like, you see, there for me was walking the opposite direction in the mall. And it wasn't some, you know, gigantic revelation. It was a small impression. Now, how does the Holy Spirit guide us? How do we know when He's leading us to a there place? Well, it's easy if He gives you a vision. It's easy if He speaks to you in a very clear way. But most of the time, His guidance is far more subtle. When Elijah was holed up in the cave, the wind was there and tore apart the rocks and said, God wasn't in the wind. And then there was a fire and it said, God wasn't in the fire. And then there was an earthquake and it said, the Lord was not in the earthquake. And then it was a still, small voice. Yes. And the Lord spoke to him. And sometimes we need to get still and listen for that whisper of the Holy Spirit. I think God can even lead us through desire. You know, Psalm 37 and 4 says, delight yourself also in the Lord, and He shall give you the desires of your heart. Now, that doesn't mean, you know, be happy in God, He'll give you whatever you want. The word delight literally means to become pliable. Like clay in a potter's hand. So it's saying that if I delight myself in the Lord, if I assume this posture of pliability that, Lord, wherever, whoever, whenever, send me. I'm here. When we assume that posture, then God begins to insert desires in our heart. And I think He'll guide us through those desires. So look with me, if you would, in Acts chapter 15. Acts the 15th chapter. Something quite profound here. Paul and Barnabas have come from their home church at Antioch with certain questions to the mother church in Jerusalem. And so they gather together to sort things out. In verse 22, it says, and it pleased the apostles and elders. This is Acts 15, 22. It pleased the apostles and elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas, namely Judas, who was also named Barsabbas, and Silas, leading men among the brethren. Come down to verse 25. This is part of a letter they wrote to the church at Antioch. They said, it seemed good to us, being assembled with one accord, to send chosen men to you with our beloved Barnabas and Paul. And then we come to verse 33. It says, after they had stayed there for a time, they were sent back with greetings from the brethren to the apostles. However, it seemed good to Silas to remain there. You know, it just feels right to be here. I'm going to stay. I'm not going to go back to the mother church in Jerusalem. Seems good. Doesn't mean anything more than that. Just, and this feels right. I'm going to stay for a while. Look what happens next. Verse 36. Then after some days, Paul said to Barnabas, let us now go back and visit our brethren to every city where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they're doing. Now Barnabas was determined to take with them John called Mark, but Paul insisted that they should not take with them the one who had departed from them in Pamphylia and had not gone with them to the work. Then the contention became so sharp that they parted from one another. And so Barnabas took Mark, sailed from Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and departed, being commended by the grace of God, by the brethren to the grace of God. Now, Paul and Barnabas, God's 1-2 punch, they split up. These are the guys in Acts chapter 13 that the Holy Spirit said, separate to me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I've called them. And they were sent out by the Holy Spirit, literally a team that had been put together by God's Spirit. And when they're going to revisit all the churches that they'd seen on their first missions trip, Barnabas wants to take John Mark. Now, John Mark was a mama's boy. He got homesick halfway through the trip and bailed on him and came back home. And Paul said, we're not taking him. And Barnabas said, no, he needs to go. Paul said, we're not taking him. The contention was so sharp, they parted ways. Barnabas took John Mark, sailed to Cyprus. And as far as the scriptural record goes, nothing is ever heard from Barnabas again. Paul now chooses Silas, and they make history. How did the Holy Spirit prepare a new companion for the Apostle Paul? Where did this next 1-2 punch come from? How did the Holy Spirit guide in all of this? Seemed good. Could it be that the Holy Spirit was guiding Silas through an impulse as subtle as this just feels right? Yes.
Amen.
Friend, the split up didn't take the Holy Spirit by surprise, even though it wasn't his will. But he knew it was coming. And so he made provision. And this decision that Silas makes that is going to impact the world, and certainly next to accepting Christ, was the most important decision he ever made in his life. How did he make it? Seemed good. I'm going to stay. I like it here. I think sometimes we hyper-spiritualize everything. And I think as we learn to become acquainted with the Holy Spirit's ways, it helps us become naturally supernatural and supernaturally natural. And the next time you have a sense, however subtle it might be, even if it's like, it's like a wisp of perfume on the breeze, take a moment. Consider it inside. Get in communion with your own heart. Say, where did that come from? Could that be the Holy Spirit talking to me? And as each of us grows closer in our relationship with the Holy Spirit, we're going to learn to discern those times when he's directing us to a place for illumination, for resource and for provision, and for mission. I think taking periodic seasons to just get quiet and listen are really important, an important Christian discipline. King David said, I communed with my own heart upon my bed. Some people and their own hearts are great strangers. Some of you need to get acquainted with your own heart because that's the part of you the Holy Spirit communicates with. Sometimes we spend our whole life in the physical realm, mentally, and we never get in touch with the core of our being, our spirit, our heart. It'll pay great dividends to you. My friend, we all need that quiet time before God. You know, the scripture says, be still and know that I am God. It would be time well spent for you to just get quiet, maybe get on your knees, read your Bible, close your eyes, and just say, Lord, speak to my heart, and just wait quietly in his presence. In our busy world, it's something that not many people take time to do, but God speaks to us, he guides us, he prompts us during those seasons of inner stillness. Let me pray for you right now. Father, I know my friend watching me may be very much like me, busy. If not busy outwardly, busy inwardly. Father, sometimes we make so much noise in our own head and our own heart, we don't really hear what you're saying, but I pray that a supernatural stillness would come as they decide to take time and wait upon you. Holy Spirit, I ask you to reveal yourself to my friend. Reveal yourself to them and guide them in this season of their life. And I ask it in Jesus' name. And I just want to finish by saying a big thank you to all of those that have joined with us in the ministry, that support us prayerfully and support us financially. You are allowing us to take messages like this around the world, literally in multiple languages, around the planet. Millions of people potentially can hear these same messages you're hearing and can find the Savior. And it's because of faithful partners. So I want to say thank you. Thank you. May God bless you for your generosity. And we will see you next time.
Over the last 30 years, through Answers with Bayless Conley, thousands of lives have been transformed around the world. Every day through our broadcast, we are reaching people with the urgent message of the gospel. This year, because of the support of our generous partners, we've been able to share the practical answers that come from God's Word to people who may have never heard it before. We have received testimonies from people that move from fear to faith and from despair to hope. And right now, thousands of people like you are finding answers from the Word of God at a time when they need it most. It's because of the generous people like you who give at BaylessConley.com that we are able to continue. Everyone faces circumstances where they need the answers only God can provide. And right now, our television outreach is how many people around the world hear the message of Jesus. When you give today, you become part of the team, bringing people the hope that can only be found through Jesus. Whether it's through our broadcast, our online presence, or our products and devotionals, your gift enables us to put vital, timely materials in the hands of those who need it most. When you go online to BaylessConley.com, you can make a difference, both now and for eternity. Your support enables us to continue to broadcast, to continue to produce materials, and to continue to be a voice of hope. Please make a monthly or one-time gift right now at BaylessConley.com. Your donation says you care about others having access to the gospel. Please go online now to BaylessConley.com to give.
We're grateful for the friends and partners of Answers with Bayless Conley who help make this program possible.